February 6th. First on our agenda is the reorganization of our committee for 2012, and I'm going to turn that over to Steve.
So I recommend Ed DeMarcantonio to be the chair and Julie Earle to be the vice chair for 2012.
I second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Next on our agenda is approval of the January 10, 2012 meeting minutes. Has everyone had a chance to review those minutes?
Yes.
Any comments? Do we have a motion?
I motion to approve those minutes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Agenda item number 3, appointment of liaison to the Shade Tree Commission. Susan?
I'd like to nominate Doug McCone to the Shade Tree Commission.
All in favor?
Second.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I second.
In favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. And item number 4, appointment of liaison to the Environmental Advisory Committee.
I'd like to nominate Skip Quindo.
I second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, Doug and Skip, for being willing to serve again. We appreciate it. Okay. Item number 5, subdivision number 212D01, preliminary final, Agnes Irwin School, to place temporary facilities to allow relocation while approved development occurs at 295 South Ithan Avenue. Is the applicant prepared?
Yeah. Nicholas Keneally representing Agnes Irwin with Kevin McCullough.
You're going to keep it very brief, right, Nick?
We are.
Okay. We appreciate
want,
that.
I'll just go. This is a pretty simple project. If you want, I'll just address David's
we
comments.
We appreciate that.
Okay. Yeah. This is for, you may recall, Agnes Irwin was approved for a new gymnasium, reconstruction of a gym and a cafeteria, about a year or two ago, I believe, probably about a year ago. This is temporary trailers to house the students for certain activities while the construction is going on. It's about 2,500 square feet. It's very similar to what Agnes Irwin had done in 2003 when they did the addition to the Liberal Arts Center. In that instance, though, it was even larger. It was like double the size of this. This is going to be about 2,400 square feet. We're using the same utilities that were installed last time, putting them in the same location, kind of in the middle of campus there near the elementary school, near the lower school. So it's kind of tucked away from neighbors' views and it's pretty unobtrusive. Just going through David's comments.
Do you have a plan that you can share with the people at home?
Yeah, sure. You'll see this is a location. Here's the upper school with the proposed addition that was approved. Here's the lower school. Here's the Arts and Center, Arts and Science building, existing library, and the proposed area, temporary facilities are going in this area right here. The last time they were on both sides of this, they were there and there. This is about the size of the previous. And what they're doing here is it's going to be basically an entranceway, a hallway. On the right side, it's going to be a lower school. Lower school music, and then on the right side would be a fitness center, basically, you know, for the school itself, because the gym is going to be under construction. It's not going to be a gym, but at least be a fitness center for them to work out. A couple of the comments. And what happened here is the way Joe Hanna, the engineer, treated it as an amendment to what was already recorded. Okay. All right, so that's why he only filed 2 pages here, because he treated it as an amendment. And I think it is a final plan, actually. And so we could just change it to a final plan. Feel free to type in at any time.
I'll stop you when I disagree.
Okay. So we're going to treat this, it is a final plan, and it should be listed as a final plan. I think they had a preliminary final. Actually, the subdivision code called for it as final. I think in the past we always termed preliminary final, but now it should be termed
okay,
final.
Okay, it's a final plan.
It's a final
Go
plan.
Go ahead.
All right. The significant man-made features, I believe, they're already existing on the recorded plan. If there's anything additional that David needs, you know, we'll be glad to put it on there. The soil type, again, is the same soil type as listed on the recorded plan. Again, we can show that on this plan. Going down to stormwater management, these facilities are temporary. We're anticipating the addition to be done for September of 2013. So they would go in around August of this year, 2012, and they would be out by September of 2013, hopefully even before that. But so we're really talking about a year as far as long as these facilities would be in there. So really, our request here is only for from August 2012 to September 2013. It's not a permanent request or anything of that nature. And that was one of David's requests. As I mentioned, the sheet numbers, he just filed two sheets, one and two, and treated it as an amendment. The modular units, they're about 2,700 square feet. I believe there's going to be two of them, Kevin. Is that how they're going to be treated, or they may be combined? You know,
most of the units that we have looked at through three or four different vendors come in various widths and lengths, but typically they are a 12 by 45 foot length, and so there will be a number of these, probably four to six of them all together to comprise the square footage that Nick has just indicated.
And they'd be grouped together into this configuration?
They're grouped together in this configuration, yes.
Again, we can put a note to the plan saying that we'll identify all the emergency service purposes in the building permit application if that's acceptable. The existing parking, currently, we've already done the parking and some of the facilities. What else was done already, Kevin?
Stormwater management.
Stormwater management and parking has already been placed in already in okay. Anticipation of all this. There's 200 parking spaces currently on the site. That's up from 175 that was existing. The requirements, 188. Again, these are temporary facilities, and actually they won't be in use at the same time as the gym and the cafeteria would be in use. The utilities are already in ground under this site here. We can make a note to the plan where the utilities are. There's no proposed sidewalks. All we'd be doing is probably doing some sort of wood chips or something of that nature leading up to the site.
There is an existing alumni walkway that connects the lower school at this end to the upper school at this end, and we would be ramping the primary entranceway from the mobile units to that walkway, and you can see there's an auxiliary or an ancillary one.
The foundation type, there's no digging or anything involved here. It's basically what I understand to be a plastic base and then on concrete blocks, and that's where the temporary facilities would be located. So there's no real digging or any foundations that are involved here. And as I mentioned, utilities are already in. Again, we could put a note in the plan regarding the foundation type, utilities already being existing there. And as I mentioned, the parking's already been constructed, and the stormwater management's already been put in. I think that kind of covers David's comments.
Okay, are the temporary facilities handicapped accessible?
They will be.
That's probably a requirement.
Yes.
Doesn't it have to?
Yes.
Okay. And how's fire code regulations? That's all okay also?
In the prior experience we had with this, that we followed the fire marshal's requirements for pull stations and connecting the existing system to our existing.
Okay, thank you. Does the board have any further questions for the applicant or the township staff?
I just have a couple of questions. So all the calculations on here are presuming with the new proposed development. That's why the
the calculations on, remember we have a recorded plan, which is the new development,
right?
And then you have this plan. I don't think he calculated into this plan, I think it was one of Davis' comments, the temporary facilities are not calculated on the plan. Is that right, David? Wasn't that one of your comments or someone's comment?
Actually, I'm Mike Taggart with Gilmore. I'm here for Dave.
Okay.
Those classrooms weren't included in those calculations on that sheet.
Okay,
that was the comment that we made.
You're going to add those, then?
Yeah, we can put them on. I guess the question is, you know, I don't think there's any additional parking requirement because we're not really using. We can put them on the sheet. I mean, I guess the other concern is, too, does it affect stormwater management if we include it? You know, because remember, these are temporary facilities, and then...
If the other part is not built yet...
No, I just wanted to clarify, I was just trying to clarify the numbers, but that's actually, the other question I have is really...
Well, let's, before you move on, Sue, the way this needs to be treated, because I don't believe our zoning ordinance nor the SALDO makes a distinction between permanent and temporary facilities. And while I think it's appropriate for you, for the applicant to request waivers on the basis that these are temporary facilities, under the SALDO, I think, Nick, you need to show and that you meet all the requirements as if these were a permanent facility, and where you feel doing that is going to create a hardship for you, you ask for a waiver and, you know, provide us with a written waiver and a written waiver request that says, you know, we're asking a waiver from this particular requirement because it's a temporary facility. You know, for example, you know, constructing a permanent stormwater basin to handle this, you know, that might be a little illogical if you're going to be removing these things within a year and a half. But you still need to show that you could or need to ask for the waiver to that requirement in order to do so. And that, following up on Susan's question, I think the numbers, and Dave's comments, the numbers on the plan, if this is going to be a revised final plan that we're recording to replace the current final plan, the numbers have got to be reflective of what's being proposed on this revision. So if there's additional parking requirements, and I don't know if there are or not, but if there are, it needs to be, you know, needs to show. If the stormwater doesn't already cover what is, you know, it looks to me, to this area, I haven't seen the plan close up, it looks to me that these are being proposed over impervious surface. If that's the case, you know, you make the argument we don't need to provide additional stormwater because it's already being provided for. If it's not, if they're being put over pervious surface, then I think you need to ask for a waiver or explain how you're going to deal with that.
Okay. All right.
Et cetera, et cetera.
And I guess the question is, too, and that was some discussion, because since it is temporary, should we record this as a permanent plan or just record the amendment? Because the
I guess my suggestion off, you know, this is kind of off the top of my head, would be to record this as a new sheet to the current plan.
Okay.
And so that this would be recorded not replacing but augmenting the current plan, and so anyone searching it later on would recognize, oh, these were temporary facilities, they've been removed, we'll abide by the other plans, and maybe put a note to that effect that this plan controls while these temporary facilities are in place, but once they're removed, you know, the plan no longer is, you know, needs to be followed.
And then just procedurally, it wasn't patently clear to me that these were amendment to the final, to the original final plan. So a couple of questions that came up for me. Would the neighbors have been notified of this?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes, they have.
All right, so neighbors are aware. And would this have gone to Delaware County Planning Commission?
It should have.
I don't know if it did. I don't see that at all.
Because I don't. Yeah, we didn't have any comments from them. And then let's see. I'm just reading down through my questions.
Yeah, because anything we file goes to Delaware County, so I assume it
okay.
did.
Yeah. The two things that I would want to just clarify is that this approval is for the temporary building only, and that we're not by approving this, we're not inadvertently approving some change to the building that we approved last
no,
year.
Not
there's,
at all.
There's no changes at all.
No, not at all.
Same size, everything.
Yep.
Okay. And that was the other confusing thing about, so page 2 does show the underground retention, but again, that was for the original
correct
development plan.
Right.
Okay. And then do we get in writing of some sort, Peter or Mike, this is a question for you, that this temporary building will be removed by a dead certain date? You know, there's temporary buildings have a habit of staying up for much longer than they're ever anticipated. And I look to the lodge at Ithan to, you know,
and
as an example.
That would be something I think that be a condition. Certainly, that's a condition that this board, planning commission can recommend, and it should be a condition that the board would consider of approval. But the issue there is like I said before, our ordinances do not contemplate temporary structures, I don't believe. So there's nothing in the ordinances that would require the applicant to say this is when we're removing it. But as part of their application, they are certainly alleging that this is going to be temporary, and they certainly are giving us a date that they hope to have it removed. I think it needs to be a discussion with you and perhaps the board whether that's a condition you want to impose, and if so, you know, what would be agreeable to the applicant.
Yeah, we would have no problem with that, and obviously it would be understood that if by some fluke we did go over, we'd have to come back here and get a modification.
I think rather than looking for, like, you know, a drop-dead date, get those buildings out of there, what I would be comfortable with is, given the fact that you could have construction delays, I would want for a provision to be in writing, you know, guaranteed to the township, that once the new facilities were occupied and mm-hmm. used, you'd have right. a certain number of, a reasonable amount of time to remove the temporary buildings. That way, if there's a catastrophe and it takes you an extra year, you know, we can be understanding and flexible, but as soon as you're in your new building and you're using it, the temporary structures are going.
That's fine.
Okay.
Peter, my last question is a quick one. I saw the conversation at the Board of Commissioners last week or 2 weeks ago about the whole preliminary slash final approval dilemma that they are trying to avoid. Is it okay for us to approve this as a final plan approval?
Because the way I'm viewing this is they have final plan approval. It's been approved. I believe, Nick, has it been recorded even?
Yes, it has.
It's been recorded. What they're coming back here is saying, we want to amend what you previously approved. And so it's not, you're not starting from scratch, which is when you get into the whole preliminary slash final. So I see this as be proper.
So, Peter, can we move forward with this tonight if we're taking your advice and having it in waiver form, where they're asking for a waiver for the stormwater or the parking, you know, the things that are going to come up here, and we also want to have a letter of guarantee that the removal of the temporary buildings would be timely?
Yes.
Do we put all that in a motion, or do we wait?
You would put that all in the motion. You could say we recommend approving this as an amendment to the existing final plan, conditioned upon, you know, a note on the plan stating that these temporary structures will be removed within 90 days after the gym building, I guess, is constructed.
Gym and cafeteria, right.
Okay. For example, it conditioned upon the applicant providing the Board of Supervisors with a written waiver request letter listing all the waivers they are seeking in accordance with this plan.
You're going to have to talk slower, Peter.
Okay. I'm sorry. Conditioned upon the applicant providing a written waiver request letter.
Do they have one, Mike? Or?
Okay. A written waiver request letter listing all of the waivers to saldo provisions that they are seeking in conjunction with this plan amendment.
Okay. We may be getting back to you on that.
Okay.
Any other questions from the board?
Oh, Susan, one thing. We did January 23rd a letter from Delaware County Planning Commission, so they did receive it.
Thank you.
Is this over, is it over grass or is it over black?
It's over grass. Yeah, so we're going to have to.
It's flat.
And it's in the footprint area is what, 2,500 square feet?
Yeah, 2,400, I believe.
It's 27.
27, excuse me.
27. Can't read it, but they, all right, thank you.
Anybody else? Is there any public comment? Please step up to the microphone. Thank you, Nick.
I'm Elaine Scherer. I live at 231 South Eithan Avenue. I'm concerned, I know they've in additions for parking, and I know we still, when they have games and, you know, alumni days, parking is very tight. Now, with the construction, will the construction and bring about more parking, that we are apt to have parking all the way up the number of houses along our street for over a year? I think this is a little asking a little too much. So my question is, what is being done about the parking, especially for the contractors and building people?
Hang on, we want to get all the public comment, and then we'll ask the applicant to address your question.
Right.
Is there any other public comment? Please go right ahead.
Over the course of this summer just passed, we approved and completed what we are calling a limited work authorization to address stormwater and parking-related issues. And I'll attempt to show you on the plan where we have added parking as part of that.
Yeah, we now have 200 spaces on the plan. Previously, there were 175, so we added 25 parking spaces.
There's a new bay of parking running parallel to the middle and upper school building that added 14 spaces. And there is parking now at the entrance immediately to the left at the lower school.
And that's there now?
It is. Yeah, these are currently installed. There's 10 spaces immediately to your left, followed by an additional 5. We also have grass paver parking behind the existing lower school building that you see between the school and Conestoga Road. The contractors will be required to confine parking of their vehicles to the area where the work is being done on site and to off-site parking, according to our contract with them. So this will be what they are calling the laydown and staging area, all in this area.
So they will not be taking up any of the spaces required for the school?
Where is the off-site parking?
That's to be determined. That's within the contractual obligation they have to find that.
That won't be on the streets, though, in the neighborhoods?
No.
Okay.
How did you put the parking within the 60-foot setback for parking along South Ithan?
We got relief on that because it was existing.
At zoning?
At zoning. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, would anyone like to make a motion?
Well, actually, I just wanted to make
one.
Yeah,
please do.
I don't think it's a long discussion.
I would
be inclined to follow Peter's guidance here and have them update their parking calculations and their stormwater to reflect the 2,700 square foot building. Although it's temporary, this is an area that actually has some water issues, and it certainly has some parking issues. And, you know, it sounds like they added enough parking spaces to cover the additional 3 spots they'll need, but the parking calculation should reflect it. 2,700 square feet would put 3 more spots there. And with regard to stormwater management, if they have to make their stormwater basin a little bit bigger, that's only going to be a good thing in the long run for this area, in my opinion.
Did you say that the stormwater basin was already done?
Yes, it has been.
That's what I thought.
As a matter of fact, it is in this area of the lower school field.
Is it oversized at all?
It is.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, it accommodates water both from Ithan Avenue and from the Edenton community immediately to the west of the school.
Will that cover the additional 2,700 feet?
Oh, certainly.
All right. So you could put that in writing?
We'll look
on
at the
update.
Engineer to do that.
Okay.
Anything else?
I'll make a motion that we recommend approval of this, with the addition of the waivers, which I'll let you read, since you wrote them down.
Okay.
Do you want me just to repeat?
Why don't you take a stab?
I can repeat what I said before, and if I forgot something, let me know.
Okay.
Does that work? So you're going to recommend approval conditioned upon the Gilmore letter of February 1st, I assume, with the applicant either complying with the comments contained in this letter or requesting a waiver to those comments in a written waiver letter, conditioned upon a note being placed on the plan that the temporary structure is removed within X days. This is a policy issue for you guys.
I was thinking 60. Are you comfortable with that?
That's fine.
60.
Within 60 days of the gym and cafeteria building being occupied. Maybe Nick, does Township Issue COs?
Yeah, they should.
They should, so upon issuance of a CO, 60 days? And then conditioned upon the applicant, this is kind of circling back around, applicant providing a written waiver letter for all waivers requested. Does that cover everything? Did I forget anything?
Nicely done.
Thank you.
Second?
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, item number 6 on our agenda for tonight is subdivision 2011-D06, preliminary for Cabrini College to construct parking structures at 610 Eagle Road, St. David's, Pennsylvania. Is the applicant prepared?
Good evening. Joanne C. Meister for Cabrini. We're back here this evening to address a couple of traffic issues that were raised the last time and to answer the questions that were posed. And with me this evening, I have our traffic expert, Frank Tafani from Tafani and Associates, to speak directly to the issues that were raised at that time.
Okay, 1 second. We also have a traffic person here on staff. Could you identify yourself?
Amy Kaminsky from Gilmore and Associates.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. As you heard, my name is Frank Tavani. I'm a traffic engineer. I believe I've appeared before this commission in the past. But to those who may not recognize me, I've been in practice in the state of Pennsylvania for the last 19 years. Started off in 1993 at Orth Rogers and Associates in Philadelphia, PA. Was there for 10 years and went off on my own about 9 years ago. I brought with me a PDF slideshow. It's not really a slideshow, but it's a PDF. And I brought that with me because instead of just going from slide to slide to explain a few things, I wanted the ability to zoom in and zoom out because some of these sheets have a lot of numbers on them. And it's my understanding, in fact, since I did not attend the last Planning Commission meeting where Cabrini presented, that a lot of this was distilled just to one figure with the intention of trying to simplify the information, maybe make it a little bit more interesting than sometimes even we traffic engineers find it to be. But I think there were more questions than one figure lend itself to answering, so I brought pretty much all of them with me. And what I would ask is you allow me to go through this. I'll be pretty brief, but still detailed. Some questions that you may have may be answered in later slides. And there are some additional slides I prepared, which might also address some questions that were raised at the last meeting.
How long do you anticipate that this would take to do it this route?
I'm going to bet 10 minutes.
That's great.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So what you see on the screen is figure 2 from the traffic impact assessment that was prepared in May 2011. And this is just being shown briefly for purposes of orientation. You can see in the black lettering where it says site at the bottom, that is the parking structure we're all here talking about. 711 spaces are proposed in that structure, along with an access to Eagle Road. I'm going to try and use the pointer to aid conversation. Of course, there's an existing access on Eagle opposite Paul, an existing access on King of Prussia just north of Eagle, and an existing access outside of the township on Upper Gulf Road. Now, this traffic investigation was really no different than any other traffic investigation in that the first thing we do is collect data. And the data is collected on a per turning movement basis, and it's typically collected during 2 peak hours. And the numbers are actually fairly larger than I thought they would turn out to be. But all the remaining figures will have 2 parts, a top and a bottom. The top is the AM peak hour and the bottom is the PM. These counts were actually conducted by Traffic Planning and Design as part of its efforts for Eastern University late in 2010. And to be consistent with that effort, since it's very closely related to ours, a decision was made to use some of their data and supplement it with some FTA data. So what you see along Eagle Road at Paul and at King of Prussia is actually taken directly from the Eastern traffic study that was submitted in late 2010. FTA conducted some additional counts at the King of Prussia Road access for Cabrini. Now, at the time that this was prepared, it was my feeling, and it continues to be my feeling, that the majority, if not the entirety, of the traffic activity along Upper Gulf Road will continue to stay along Upper Gulf Road, which goes in and out of this institution. There has been some discussion that we had internally in the months that came after this study was published. There's some conversations we've had with Gilmore, in fact, as recently as last week, and I understand that there are some people on the commission and some residents that also believe some distribution may take place, or namely some traffic from Upper Gulf may find its way to Eagle Road. Now, what you're going to see on these figures does not reflect that, and I don't want you to think this disingenuous. We actually do have some slides later that show what the volume activity is like on Upper Gulf, and I'm prepared to speak a little bit with more, a little bit more intelligently as to what would actually happen if some of that traffic moved to Eagle. But for now, the study that was submitted and to this point reviewed by Gilmore focuses just on what would happen at these two locations. So I'm going to zoom in just a little bit more. I think that's probably big enough to see all these different volumes. The two driveways opposite Paul and along King of Prussia Road constitute the total inbound and outbound traffic for this lower half of the university. And if you add up all the individual turning movements, so for example, on the eastbound approach, this is traffic coming from the west heading east on Eagle, there are four people during the a.m. peak hour, which is incidentally approximately 8 a.m. to 9 a.m., 245 people going through and 11 turning right. That's over a one-hour period. So if you want to look to see how much total entering traffic there is at the driveway opposite Paul, it's the sum of 4, 19, which is the northbound through, and 2, which is the westbound right. So it gives you a total of about 25 vehicles. And what's coming out, 0 turning left, 3 going through, and 6 turning right, that's 9. To do the same thing over at King of Prussia Road and add everything up, you get the total shown in green and red above the word site, which is for these two driveways, 115 total vehicles entering the entire site at those two driveways during the AM peak hour and 26 leaving. During the PM peak hour, the volumes coincidentally are almost identical entering and exiting. This is probably as classes are turning over. And this traffic reflects not only students, but faculty, staff, visitors, really all the traffic going in and out of the site. I should point out that there's obviously existing parking on the campus today. There's 952 total parking spaces on the campus today, and there's approximately 1,300 students being served today. In the future, the parking is expected to grow to, I believe it's 1,023 for an increase of 71 spaces, the majority of which will be located in the parking structure, 711. So I see some of you writing those numbers down. That's good, because these are important numbers. Again, it's 952 existing parking, 1,023 future parking. The difference is 71. That's an increase of about 7.5%. Now, it's my understanding, and I'm probably getting ahead of myself. In fact, I am getting ahead of myself. We'll go to the next slide. The next thing that traffic engineers do after they look at the existing volumes is try and relate that volume to capacity at intersections and assign a score or a grade. We call it a level of service. And a level of service is not unlike a report card grade, where A is the highest and most desirable level of service, and F represents a condition where the traffic demand exceeds the capacity of either a turning movement or an approach or potentially an intersection as a whole. So if you look at this slide, this again is the AM peak hour existing conditions, you see that the two driveways serving the site operate not only acceptably, but I would argue favorably, with conflicting movements operating at levels of service A, B, or C. Now, when you're at an unsignalized intersection, not all traffic stops. In fact, the traffic, for example, that's heading through along King of Prussia or Eagle has no stop sign, so free flow movement, so there's no delay, and there's no level of service grade. It's only traffic that has to yield to opposing through traffic, like left turns from a main street to a side street, or traffic on a side street trying to exit that has any kind of calculable delay, which is why you only see a few letters for the two driveways.
Would you explain briefly what A, B, C, and D mean? I mean, like, for example, I'm over here. Off in the distance. A means it performs perfectly?
I mean, well, that's probably being generous. A means that according to the highway capacity manual, that the average motorist typically waits less than 10 seconds before he or she is able to make his or her turning movement. And you have to imagine this statistically, so a vehicle going through that intersection, making that movement an nth number of times, or some, you know, 1,000 times. Sometimes he or she won't wait at all, and the delay will be zero. Sometimes it might be longer because there's more opposing through traffic at that particular instance. But on average, And you don't see those numbers shown here, and that's because typically when the levels of service are this favorable, they're just not identified. I do have those numbers buried in the appendix of the report that was submitted. The one parenthetical number you do see is during the AM peak hour northbound on King of Prussia Road is the 135 for an F. Typically, at least in my nomenclature, if it's a failing movement, I will show what the delay is per vehicle. So for that movement, the average delay is 135 seconds, which basically means that if you're trying to go that direction during that peak hour, you're probably going to be waiting 2 minutes or at least one cycle length before you'll be able to get through. And you probably have that experience because that intersection is somewhat constrained. They're all one-lane approaches today, and it's signalized, and there's more delay at signalized intersections than unsignalized intersections.
Mr. Dabini?
Yes.
These numbers that you're showing us here are from May of 2011. Is that correct?
No. May indicates when the figure was prepared. These counts were actually the counts along Eagle Road were conducted, I believe it was in November 2010, which was when TPD put their study together. But TPD, of course, did not conduct counts at the Cabrini-only driveway along King of Prussia Road, since their client was Eastern. So we conducted those counts, and they were conducted, I believe, in April or May.
Because I'm looking at a letter from our from Gilmore Associates saying that the May 2011 traffic volumes were original, but we're now not using those ones because we have better figures. So are those reflected in the numbers you're showing us now?
Could you repeat that? I'm not familiar with the comment you're reading. I've seen the letters. I don't have it in front of me, so I'm not sure exactly what it says.
Or maybe says, among other things, the three-day average from the September 2011 ATR data indicates that the AM traffic.
Oh, no, that's the most recent letter from last week.
Yes.
Yeah, that's talking about automatic traffic recorder data, which we will get to later in this presentation.
But it says that it was significantly greater than the May 2011 traffic volumes. And is that what we're looking at here, the May 2011 traffic volumes?
Yes.
Well, then it's irrelevant to us right now because we've already realized that. While it's nice to explain how traffic engineering works, and that might be helpful for people, if we've already established that these numbers are significantly less than what we're dealing with in reality, then we don't want to spend a long time going over them.
Well, nothing has changed yet in this traffic study, so I thought I would first at least explain what was attempted to be summarized last time. We are obviously going to respond to that letter, which we just received on Wednesday last week. And I believe the comment that you're reading from doesn't describe every single traffic volume or turning movement that was counted as being inadequate or less than. I don't have that letter in front of me right now because I came prepared to talk about what we tried to present last time. We did receive that letter. We don't disagree with anything in it. And in fact, we have every reason to embrace every notion that was written there. But I don't believe that statement was necessarily characterizing the individual turning movements from the May report as being inadequate for any purpose. And at this point, I think I'd like to hear from Gilmore to see if maybe I'm misspeaking.
Well, if you'd like to finish what you're saying, we
don't
want
to
interrupt
you. I would like to finish,
yes. You can finish.
Oh, thank you. It's very courteous.
We want to give you every chance to say what you want to say. I just want to make sure we're not spending time on something we've already moved past.
I appreciate that. But, this is actually very topical because.
I just have one other question.
Yes.
Were these traffic studies done while school was in session?
Well, of course, yes.
Well, I mean, November's, there's Thanksgiving, April, there's spring break. So it was not during spring break and it was not during Thanksgiving.
That's correct. The data was collected during normal school periods. And in fact, another reason why we reused some of TPD's data is because we moved forward on our project a little bit after they did. And as some of you may recall, in the spring of 2011, there actually was some reconstruction going on King of Prussia Road, and that caused some detours and some changes in travel patterns. So we were in kind of a quagmire as to whether or not to wait until the summer, because, again, this was the spring. I believe the construction had just started, and it was termed to last until September 2011, and we didn't think it was pragmatic to wait 3 or 4 months, especially when we had data from another willing consultant that was prior to the detour. Anyway, now that I have the letter, I should probably just point out that I believe you were reading from page 2, comment 1?
Yes.
Okay. So it says, the full line says, September 2011 ATR data indicates that the AM traffic volumes into the campus were significantly greater than the May 2011 traffic volumes that were included in the original TIA. Please note the PM peak hour traffic volumes are comparable. And then if you go down underneath that comment, there's a table where Gilmore summarizes the ATR average, and this is the average during the peak hour, total in and total out at King of Prussia Road and the Eagle Road accesses as compared to what's in the traffic study. And I really didn't expect that we would get into this minutia of detail, but I'm happy to continue to go through this if you'd like. If you look in the table, you'll see that where it says ATR average under King of Prussia in AM, it's 195 vehicles. Original TIA, it's 90. If you go over to the Eagle Road access under AM in, it's 17 for ATR. Under original TIA, it's 25. So in the Eagle Road access, the entering AM peak hour traffic was actually greater in the TIA as opposed to the ATR data, whereas at King of Prussia, it was less. And if you continue to go through this, you can really pretty much find any data you'd like or come to any conclusion that you desire. But what I'm trying to illustrate here is that for these driveways, we have superior levels of service. We have A, Bs, and Cs. So even if you want to take this existing volume that was carried over in some cases from TPD, in some cases from FTA, and increase it by any factor that the ATRs may suggest or any other factor, it's not really going to change the performance of these driveways in any meaningful way, I think. But I will continue to investigate that as I've been asked to do by Gilmore.
One quick comment.
Yes.
I think we could delete any reference to the existing Eagle Road access, not because it's going to be closed, and it'll go somewhere else, but it's very de minimis right now.
That's true. I'll quit while I'm ahead and go to the next slide.
What B, C, and D? I mean, what if is B 20 seconds?
Oh,
C 30 seconds?
You know, I don't have the breakdown committed to memory. There's actually a different scale for A to B for signalized versus unsignalized, and that's because motorists are generally acclimated to waiting longer at signalized intersections than they are at stop-controlled intersections. So the scale is different for both of them. But I can tell you that roughly for a signalized intersection, it cuts off at around 80 seconds for failure. The E to F is around 80 seconds. And then it breaks down, not exactly uniformly from there, but you know, I think D to E might be 60 seconds, so it's a 20-second spread. But the good news is the driveways operate with relatively little delay today, and there is more delay at the intersection of King of Prussia and Eagle. And we're only on slide 5, so I'm going to try and speed things up. The next thing that a traffic engineer does is looks at the future no-build condition, and that's because any project should always be comparing apples to apples. You don't want to look at the existing condition and say that's your baseline. You want to look at some point in the future, in this case about 4 years in the future, assuming that we get the permits necessary to move forward, and see what might be happening at that point in time and say that is your base and compare that to what you're planning on doing. So this figure 5 from the report, is the future no build. And what this reflects is existing traffic grown by a certain percentage for a certain number of years as promulgated by PennDOT. And then whatever other specific other development traffic should be added to reflect what's going on in this immediate vicinity, which in this case was Eastern University's proposed new student center. So their traffic study, having been done a few months before ours, was incorporated in these volumes. And again, I won't go through all these in any great detail, but they're there. Then the levels of service are run again under that future no build condition. And we look to see whether or not anything changes meaningfully. And one of the things I do is if there is a meaningful difference, I highlight either the letter or the delay forecasted in red that has increased. So as you can see, there's no meaningful differences at our driveways. And at the intersection of King of Prussia and Eagle, there's some significantly added delay. There's some noticeable added delay to the northbound approach. I don't even know if I would call it significant, but it's some noticeable delay.
Did you take into account the improvements that are proposed for a turning lane in King of Prussia with these calculations?
Later on, yes.
Okay.
Now, one of the more unique aspects of this project is, as we know, we're talking about a new driveway, which is probably going to have an impact on the existing driveways. And in fact, not probably, it certainly will. So we have to not only increase traffic, as you typically would for a development, but we have to redistribute the existing traffic to account for that new driveway and this change in the site. So in order to determine with some reason how that would be accomplished, I looked at these two driveways first. Again, this is going back a year now. And for all the entering and exiting traffic, assigned a letter, and then used a combination of forecasting from looking at the existing volumes, just using some common sense for what a motorist would do, and even adding in some of what we knew at the time to be changes at Paul Road, and redistributed traffic from those two driveways to the site driveway. Now, I'm not going to go through and explain all this, obviously, because it takes me a little bit to look at it and even remember it myself. But this is a very, it was a very well thought out process, which again was presented to Gilmore, and to this point has not been discarded, although recently there was a request made to add Upper Gulf Road into the mix and redistribute some traffic from that driveway down to this driveway as well. That's not shown in this model, but it will be shown as soon as I have am afforded an opportunity to respond to the letter we got last week. But that's just the model. The next figure is what those actual trips are. So figure 8 is the redistribution of existing traffic expressed as trips. In some cases, some turning movements will actually be reduced. Some traffic will be taken, for example, from northbound through traffic along King of Prussia, and most likely be added to the left turn movement to enter the site. So that, although you could say it's a disbenefit to that left turn movement, it's a benefit to the through movement, because it's actually taking some traffic out of that stream and adding it to Eagle Road heading west. And then we have the AM and the PM breakdown. Next, and finally, there's the issue of new traffic. Now, this project in and of itself, especially reflective of the fact that, as I mentioned earlier, we're only adding 71 spaces to the entire campus, and I think some of that was just for code compliance and not necessarily because of a perceived need. This project in and of itself does not include any classroom space. It doesn't include anything that's going to increase the student body. It's really an amenity to the campus that's going to help keep Cabrini competitive in the marketplace and serve existing needs. Now, we do know that historically we've had more students at this campus. And we also know that there's a certain number of students that makes sense to have no more than, because there's certain disincentives to just how it complicates things with faculty, staff, and other expenses related to the campus, or so I'm told. So although we have 1,300 today, the intent is really, whether this project moves forward or not, is to never exceed 1,500 on the campus, at least at present thinking. Now, that increase, going from 1,300 to 1,500 students, is a 15% increase. The increase in parking is 7.5%, coincidentally, or half as much of an increase. That potential theoretical student body increase is 15%. Now, even though that student increase has nothing to do with this project directly, what I did was applied that 15% growth in student body to the existing volumes at these two driveways to see how much ad traffic that would be. And then that was distributed based on a different trip distribution model, which really follows existing volume patterns. And that was presented in the report as figure 9. And it's really not that much traffic. You may remember in the AM peak hour, there's about 120 vehicles entering in the morning, and I think around 20 exiting. So 15% of that is not that much, and that's what those numbers are there. And the same thing for the PM. It's about 20 vehicles each way. So then finally, you add all those previous sheets up, and you get the future build volumes, which are shown in figure 10, and then the future build levels of service, which are figure 11. Now, what's important here, there's a few things important here. First, all the driveways are continued to be forecasted as operating at levels of service A, B, and C. And there are some improvements that Eastern University mentioned in its presentation and is contemplating at the intersection of King of Prussia Road and Eagle. And at the time this study was put together, it was thought that those improvements would be a northbound left and an eastbound right. And now I believe it actually includes a third lane, a southbound left, really mostly for geometric reasons, just to mirror the northbound left, even though the volume turning on the Pine Tree is relatively low. So what my study did was it looked at this intersection two ways. First, it looked at how much different it would be if there were no physical improvements, and it was just the added traffic due to our site and Eastern and the background growth. And then looked at it if these lanes were added, and in fact, if only two of the three lanes were added. And in both cases, in the AM and PM, we have generally levels of service A, B, and C. Couldn't get rid of 1D southbound in the AM peak hour, but overall it's a C and it's a dramatic improvement. Now, that was what I did in the old study. Now, one of the things that we've subsequently done later in 2011, mostly for our own curiosities at that point, not really because there was a question, was see how much traffic there is out of the township in the Upper Gulf Road driveway. And I prepared this figure, which isn't numbered and is dated incorrectly. This was actually, I think, in November of 2011, these counts were conducted. And this is a traffic picture along Upper Gulf. So in the morning, we have about 120 vehicles entering, 54 turning right, 67 turning left, and about 21 leaving. And you can see there's around 700 vehicles total in both directions along Upper Gulf. And in the afternoon, 36 and 34 leaving left and right respectively, and 12 and 32 entering right and left respectively. Now, I know one of the questions that keeps coming up is, isn't some of this traffic going to find its way down Radnor Road or some other arterial to connect to Eagle because that's where all the parking is? One of the things I failed to do earlier in the presentation is point out, so I'll do it now, is that there will still be some interconnectivity among the site from all the driveways, although obviously the shortest path from any outside roadway, Eagle in this case, to the parking structure would be from the Eagle driveway. You can still get to parking on campus. And remember, there's 1,023 spaces on campus and 711 in the structure. So there's still about 400 parking spaces throughout other parts of the campus other than the structure. So some of the people that are using King of Prussia Road driveway and Upper Gulf Road driveway will continue to use that today or in the future. Some people may be relocated to Radnor. So let's talk about that for a minute. What's really likely to happen? These 67 people that are turning left, they're coming from King of Prussia Road. I would submit that even though I didn't interview those 67 people, I would think none of them are coming from points south on King of Prussia Road, south of Eagle. And that would simply make sense because all of those people would either turn into the driveway on King of Prussia Road or turn on Eagle and enter at Paul, because that would be the shortest path. All of those people are probably coming from the north on King of Prussia Road, heading south, turning right onto Upper Gulf to enter the site. Now, as we know, the dog leg of Upper Gulf and King of Prussia does get a little constrained at times. It's two offset opposite T intersections. As you're heading south on King of Prussia, there's an exclusive right turn lane. And I would think that some people may be entering the site here, not only because there's parking there that they're going to, or there's a building there that they're going to, but maybe because they just want to avoid the congestion on King of Prussia Road. And I think those people will continue to feel compelled to act in the same way in the future. So I don't think any of that traffic is going to redistribute itself to Eagle. And the same thing would apply to the traffic that's leaving turning right. So that just leaves 54 people in the morning who are turning right coming from the west, and 5 in the morning who are leaving turning left heading west. Even if all that traffic redistributed itself to Radnor or other roads and went down Eagle to come into the new driveway, this amounts to less than one vehicle per minute during the AM peak and even less than that during the PM peak. It's a sum of 12 and 36. And although I haven't done it yet, I have been asked to do it last week by Gilmore, and I anticipate finding, and I believe Gilmore's letter also hinted at the end, that there probably will be no changes in levels of service or performance at the driveways along Eagle Road as a result of that. But I will investigate it. I know another question that was asked is how much traffic Cabrini generates at other hours of the day, which is a very legitimate question. And what this figure shows, which is rather poorly labeled, but I can explain, is the total inbound and outbound traffic activity on Wednesday, on a Wednesday in September when we conducted the ATR counts that were summarized in Gilmore's February 1st letter. This data was presented to Gilmore 2 weeks ago and was the basis of their review letter. This is just one of the days I just grabbed at random. Again, we had Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. The hours at the bottom are the hour ending, so the first bar is from 12 a.m. to 1 a.m., the next is 1 a.m. to 2, etc. So you can see that for this peak here, this is from 8 a.m. to 9 a.m., which, as you may recall, is the AM peak that we examined in the report. And this is the total inbound and outbound activity at all three driveways for the campus. So there's about 275 vehicles making all those movements. During the next hour, it's marginally more, but again, this is over three driveways. And putting aside the scale, which is really kind of meaningless, you have to look at the numbers on the left and see that the difference is only about 20 or 30 vehicles per hour divided over three driveways, meaning the impact of looking at that hour is really relatively insignificant in terms of levels of service. During the PM, the picture is a little bit stronger. 3 to 4 is close to 400 vehicles. 5 to 6 is closer to 300 vehicles. There's a difference of 100. But again, this is over three driveways, which means it could be as many or as little as 20 or 40 vehicles per hour total at each of these driveways being impacted by that different clock hour. But it does appear that, at least for this 1 hour, which is conspicuously the highest, that maybe it was wrong to look at 5 to 6, and maybe we should have looked at 3 to 4, which is what that data suggests. Now, we did not conduct our own ATR counts along King of Prussia Road, Eagle Road, or Upper Gulf Road as part of any of our efforts to date. But there's an entity called the DVRPC, Delaware Valley Regional Planning Commission, which on its website, dvrpc.org, does offer for free traffic counts and data that you can download and print. So this count happened to be conducted on King of Prussia Road between Eagle and Upper Gulf not that long ago, in the late October 2011. And I'll make it a little bigger. What it shows is that The total traffic along King of Prussia Road, which includes Cabrini and Eastern and commuters and everyone else, from 8 to 9, they use hour beginning, whereas I used hour ending, from 8 to 9 is at a maximum, it's 1,086. And from 5 to 6 is near a maximum at 1091. It's actually about 1 or 2% greater from 4 to 5. But it clearly shows that although there is traffic in the middle of the day, just like Cabrini has traffic in the middle of the day, probably the 1 hour between 7 to 9, which is generally defined as the AM commuter peak hour, and 1 hour between 4 to 6 is a reasonable representation of the maximum traffic on these roadways, including Cabrini, but also including all other traffic. And that is what's appropriate to study, because by definition, all other hours, even if a site has more traffic added at that time, the component traffic of all those different traffic populations will still be comparable to, or in most cases, less than. So basically, if you can make the worst hour operate acceptably, by definition, all the other hours typically operate that way as well. Now, that's just King of Prussia. I also found one on Eagle. This was a little bit older. It was in 2005, and it was between Woodland and Paul. And this coincidentally shows the same general trend. From 8 to 9, it was 545, which was a clear peak. And from 5 to 6, it was 757, which was also a clear peak as compared to the other hours. So I believe that the hours that we examined continue to be the proper hours. And despite my beliefs that the redistribution of any traffic from Upper Gulf is either negligible or will not have an effect on the findings of the May 2011 study, we will, of course, comply with Gilmore's letter from February 1st and investigate this further.
Okay, thank you.
That was longer than 10 minutes, but I apologize. I did my best.
I do have one question. One of the, we have the route, I'm sorry, I'm over here on your left again. The route that goes, they're taking parking away from the areas along where that entrance is from Upper Gulf Road, right? And part of the plan is to take some of that and shift it into the parking garage.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
What is the route that is going to go from, I mean, how difficult will it be right now? I mean, will it be a straight line? Will they have to take a lot of curvature turns and so forth? In other words, will the route through the campus become a deterrent to people using the Upper Gulf Road to go to the other roads?
I understand your question. I don't think there's any simple answer to that. I don't think it's going to be a direct path. I don't think it's going to be so serendipitous as to really change certain people's behaviors. Some people just like to drive down certain roads as part of their commute and will continue to do it even if their destination happens to be slightly different from one day to the next. But again, at this point, I'm conceding, I'm making a concession that we will redistribute some of the traffic from Upper Gulf to Eagle. I will continue to deny that any traffic that's heading to or from the east, which, as I said earlier, is most likely coming to and from the north, will go to Eagle, because those people will just be going completely out of their way. They'll be traveling two or three times as far. If they're coming from the north on King of Prussia Road and they're heading into Upper Gulf making a left, they're certainly not going to go past that driveway, go down to Radnor, make another left, go down south to Eagle, make another left. I mean, at the most they might do is go south on King of Prussia, unlike they're doing today, and go down to the signal and make a right and go into our new driveway there. But that wouldn't really impact any of the concerns of anyone may have to the west. And I continue to think people will avoid the dogleg on Upper Gulf and King of Prussia and still won't do that. We're talking about 60 trips in the AM peak hour and 45 trips in the PM peak hour that really could potentially be relocated. And that's probably what we're going to do. We'll just be conservative and assume all 100% of them actually do shift themselves. The only consequence of this is that there might be added left turn activity at the driveway on Eagle, and that could potentially require other improvements like a left turn lane. And we've already started looking into that, but we don't know just yet.
Well, the other question I have.
Hang on.
Sorry.
Well, I've heard the traffic report now, and now I'd like to hear from Amy. Does that work for you? Okay. Amy, can you step up and give us a brief review of what was the most important letter points in your letter?
Well, I'm not saying that the study that he provided wasn't consistent and include what we had discussed in our meeting, but the information that was provided led me to have more questions and more things that I felt needed to be looked at. One of the issues, and I wasn't as concerned about the level of service deficiency with the redistributed trips on Upper Gulf. I'm more concerned about what that'll do and what kind of impact that'll have on Eagle Road entrance. Will a left turn lane be required We're sitting right at the warranting threshold for including a eastbound left turn lane at that entrance. And my concern is that if we don't take that into consideration, and what I think will happen, we have a difference of opinion on what's going to occur, because I do my driving based on minimum time path, what's my quickest way to get from point A to point B. And I don't think going through a college campus would be the most direct route to the parking garage. I believe the majority of the traffic is going to come down to Eagle and enter through that area. And I just want to make sure that it's designed correctly. So that's where a lot of those questions that I brought up were leading to.
Do you believe that the increased impact of the traffic turning down that road to get to the parking garage could be alleviated with those design improvements?
They could be. If those are, yes, they could be resolved. I think that the improvements that are on the table currently for the Eastern University highway occupancy permit for the northbound left turn lane, the southbound left turn lane, and the eastbound right turn lane from Eagle to head south on King of Prussia Road would help the situation for the development at Cabrini. But I do have some concerns about the left turn lane at the Eagle Road access into the campus.
Now I have a question for all of you. Do you want to continue to talk just about the traffic issues now, or do you want to open the discussion up to other issues on this application as a whole, or would you rather continue to focus right now on the traffic issues?
I want one other question.
Go ahead.
One of the comments was made that they were going to close the what is currently the entrance that comes off of Eagle Road onto Paul Road. Is that possible, or is that likely? What would the impact on that be?
Was that part of the? That was part of the plan. You want to address that?
Hello, I'm Howard Holden, Director of Facilities for Cabrini, and yes, we would be closing the current Eagle Road entrance to only emergency access vehicles. That's what the police and the fire now use, and I'm sure they would require that we let them continue to use that.
I have a question for you before you go away, Mr. Holden. when you allow the traffic to travel from Gulf Road through your campus down to the parking structure, are there going to be speed bumps, stop signs, and other traffic calming type of things there that would slow cars down that would theoretically force them to go onto Eagle Road from the other direction?
We currently have traffic calming devices on campus. Whether that's going to encourage travelers to use the road, the exterior roadways rather than the interior is hard to predict. There will still be a significant number of surface parking spaces available for those who are coming in from the Upper Gulf Road entrance.
Thank you.
While you're still up there also, I drove past today and I haven't been on the campus, so I don't know everything I need to know, I guess, but I noticed that there are gates
Yep.
on the Upper Gulf Road. Are there going to be gates on the Eagle Road access?
Yes, we would, for the parking structure, in order for us to continue to be a gated community, we will still need gates at the Eagle Road, the new Eagle Road access.
But if a lot of the traffic is redistributed to that access, the other thing that I mentioned at a prior meeting is that the loading area for a whole bunch of cars coming in seems very small compared to the other two driveways that enter the campus. Like, I'm worried about traffic backing out onto Eagle Road. Staging, sorry.
Yeah, we have designed the access into the parking structure to accommodate some staging.
Julia, I'm okay with if people want to stay on traffic, but just I don't want to lose sight of going back to the August 31st Gilmore letter, which was our original review.
Okay. Let me check with Mike.
Yeah, I'm just saying there's questions dating back to that original review because this has been tabled a few times that eventually I'm going to want to address because I still have my questions.
Okay. So, Mike, you're here for Dave, right? I have The January 5th letter.
January 5th.
And I guess our question is, does that include the August items? Do you know?
It does not.
Basically, what happened was they resubmitted the same plan. The only thing that changed was the driveway location.
Okay.
So all of our comments from the first letter are still applying to the current set of plans.
But they're in a different letter.
We just didn't add them. We didn't want to completely redo the whole letter.
I just want to make sure I understand what's going on.
The old letter still is needed to be complied with.
Okay.
That's what I don't want to lose sight of, is that because it was a long review letter, the August 31st.
Which is why we didn't want to repeat the whole thing. We had the comment in the beginning of the letter. It said all of our comments from the first letter still apply.
Okay. And at this stage in the development process, have those issues been discussed and solved with you, through the township staff and the applicant, or is those still things that are all in the wings?
Rob, I don't know. You might be able to answer that one better.
Well, Rob Lambert from Site Engineering Concepts. Most of the comments in that review letter, actually, they were bringing up comments, and most of it was actually going to be further addressed during final plan, when we actually have to go through the whole calculations and all the details and everything else. So although the letter looks long, if you read the comments, a lot of it said, the applicant's going to address that during final.
The problem with that, though, is that if we give preliminary plan approval without seeing some of the issues that are being addressed in this letter, we have to do final plan approval. And big ones, like just for instance, we recommend that the applicant provide elevations and perspective sketches of the proposed parking garage. We haven't seen any of those yet. And it says the applicant has indicated that the requested plans will be provided at the Planning Commission meeting. We find this to be acceptable. We've seen three times they've been here. They've not brought any elevations that I've seen. Have we seen any elevations? That's a pretty major
one. We saw a sort of a mocked-up elevation. It wasn't a detailed elevation.
Exactly.
But it was an elevation of how large the visual impact that it would have on the road.
A very bare-bones one. That was a comment from the engineer. I'm just saying 5 months has gone by. We still haven't seen more. We've typically seen a lot more detail of a plan when there's a plan of this scope and magnitude, and we've not seen it. That was one comment. We still have to talk about the issue of whether additional right-of-way along Eagle Road will be required prior to final plan approval. That's not good. I'm just saying there's issues in the original August 31st letter that we should probably go over.
Mike,
and not lose sight of that in the midst of all of our concerns about traffic and the traffic issues. That's all I'm saying.
One thing I'd just like to point out, too, I believe at the end of that letter, David Lay recommended approval of the application for preliminary.
Yes, but he doesn't get to decide. So what's the preference of the board? Would you like to go through from the letters again to go through the review, or do you want to talk more about the traffic since we have that fresh in our minds, or what would you prefer? Anybody have a preference?
I think we need to do a little both together. For example, if you need the left turn lane off of Eagle School Road, you're going to need the additional right-of-way. Where is that road's pretty narrow. Where is that additional space going to come from? Eastern side or your side?
Eagle Road's actually a state highway, so anything that we do on Eagle Road has to be approved through PennDOT, and PennDOT will determine what right-of-way they need. And Amy can correct me if I'm wrong. What right of way they will need? We did, based on the review letter last week, we did just a sketch of what a left turn lane, what impact it would have. We believe we can fit it within the current right of way. If we do need another foot or two of right of way, it would be from the Cabrini side along Eagle Road.
What's the right of way you have allotted right now? Because the minimum is required is 80 feet.
I do not believe it's the minimum. The existing, I'd have to look at the exact number.
So you'd need a waiver for that, making this not a by-right plan.
We're not proposing a subdivision, so I don't believe we need to offer any additional. But the existing is 40 feet.
Is that just on your side of the road?
No, that's full width.
So the right-of-way or the cartway?
The right-of-way is 40 feet.
How wide is the cartway?
I do not see a dimension offhand here. I think it's only one lane in either direction. I'd say at most probably 28 feet, probably less.
I believe that you have a right turn lane leading into the parking garage, into the site.
Correct.
So in order to make the transitions work from either direction, you're going to need more than 40 feet to make that alignment work out. And I do want to let you know that we do provide our comments on state roads to PennDOT directly, so they're aware of the township's position. And after the board has decided what they want to do, then that information is usually provided to PennDOT. And we find that they're usually very good about working with the townships and taking into consideration their what they would like to have.
PennDOT doesn't like to see the application either until we have some review from the township.
I agree. And they'd like them to be included in all the discussions. So thank you.
So Mike or Peter, whichever is more applicable, weigh in on 255-27C4. Do they need to provide the minimum right-of-way, even though it's not a subdivision? Comment number six on the August 31st letter.
Can you give me the site again, please?
255-27C4. It was comment six on the August 31st letter, page 3. It says, and then what the letter says is, prior to final plan approval, the township will determine whether or not additional right-of-way along Eagle will be required. Is that going to be a function of whether or not we're going to be looking for that left-hand turn lane or some other issue?
I believe, and I'm trying to find this section, but I do believe I discussed this with David earlier, and I think the applicant is correct that the way that language reads, it only applies to subdivision. My recommendation is, if they, wish to follow that hard line, and the township wishes to get that extra right of way, that certainly the township should take in consideration any other waiver requests they want, in whether or not to grant that waiver request if they're not going to give us this extra right of way. I guess, in other words, if they're going to play hardball, we can always play hardball back at them.
Susan, can you point out the most important things in the August letter? Because I think a lot of us have the more recent letter.
Okay, which didn't encompass any of these comments. That was my concern.
We could ask Mike to do it, but I think that because Dave wrote the letter.
Yeah, that's
fine. If you have it in front of you, you could go ahead.
I do. The concerns I had were elevations. That was comment number two about the elevations and perspectives that we really have seen very little.
Okay.
Requirement was the highway occupancy permit, which I'm assuming they'll comply with that.
Not worried.
The boulevard entrance was a concern raised in the August letter, but they've now changed that to the minimum for the two-way entrance was 25 feet. They were showing 24, but now they're saying it's a boulevard, so I think that one's taken care of.
Okay.
And then there were a variety of concerns about the stormwater. Under the general comments, there were stormwater management facility concerns. But you know what? Let's not put Mike on the spot.
No.
If we talk about parking and driving concerns, maybe he can look that over a little bit. The one that it had to do with providing additional information about stormwater management, which, because this is on the hill, just want to make sure that going downhill, into Eastern and then the neighbors behind that, that everything about stormwater management is dealt with.
Isn't that usually addressed in the final plan, not in the preliminary?
They had a lot of concerns that they raised, and I just was, Mike, you look like you want to say something.
Yeah, I mean, we did have some concerns because we didn't have a design report, and some of the other applications that we get during preliminary, they do submit reports. This one, we just had some questions. We wanted to get them down on paper to make sure that we were on the same page with Rob during his design. As far as the runoff coming down the hill, Rob, correct me if I'm wrong, but you have curb?
Right, we have curb.
Yeah, so that wasn't necessarily one of our concerns.
And just to clarify, we actually provided calculations. They were, they're preliminary calculations is what they are.
They were basic.
We haven't gone through every detail. We're currently proposing three underground stormwater management basins underneath our loop road. Again, it's just working out those details during final.
Great. Yeah, we try not to wait until final to do everything, because what happens is everything is so finished when it gets to us at the final stage that we end up making a lot of concessions that we should not be making. If we can address these things now, even though some of it's not required at the preliminary stage, we're going to bring it up now because we want you and everyone else to know what we're thinking, where we're headed, so that when the final plans come back, it's not a huge battle.
Absolutely.
Everybody's on the same path.
Those were my concerns. I just wanted to make sure they got addressed.
So now let's look again at the letter, the more recent letter, not the traffic letter, the more recent letter from Dave.
January 5th?
The January 5th letter. And if Mike, if you could take us through that, just to point out anything that you think is the most significant parts of that. That's a shorter letter, obviously.
Some of the comments came from an in-house meeting with the fire marshal and emergency services, basically making sure that they had access to some of the houses that were going to lose their access because of the parking garage. That was what a few of the first comments were. Mainly it was just ensuring that they had appropriate emergency facilities for fire hydrants and access.
We don't have any problem with that. We actually met with the fire marshal, I believe it was August or September. Richard King from WRT and I met with him, went over the plans. We were fine with all the comments there.
Okay, thank you. Does the board have any questions about either the traffic or anything else for the applicant or the township staff?
I actually have a traffic question. It's back on your PowerPoint presentation. I want to follow how this math works. It would be page 2.
Yep.
The AM peak.
Yep.
When I add to the eastbound.
Oh, I know what you're going to do already.
No. When I add the eastbound on Eagle Road of 245 with the eastbound coming up Paul and taking a right, I get to 373.
Mm-hmm.
So to my way of thinking, approximately 373 should be eastbound on King of Prussia Road, but in fact it's only 295. So what happens to the other 78 cars?
That's a very good question. I get those questions a lot. Typically some traffic is gained and lost at intervening driveways and intersections between what appears to be two continuous points on simplifications of figures like this. But in this case we have, for example, Eastern University across the street as well as some residences. And I mean, frankly, there is some difference in traffic just from one count location to the next because we have people out doing these counts. Sometimes their clocks might not be synchronized to the minute, and sometimes you lose a little bit of traffic because of that. So I call them deltas, the difference between departing and approaching traffic along links, and I do look at them pretty carefully to see if they make sense. And in this case, I think it's explained by what could be between those two points, or what is between those two points.
And would 78 be an acceptable number to be off?
There is some engineering judgment there, and again, not to pick on someone else, but again, these are volumes that were published by TPD in their report for Eastern University, so this was already to some extent looked at by another traffic engineer and reviewed by the township before it even got to me to include in this report. But you know, whether 10%, 20%, is it a whole number, is an acceptable delta? I mean, it really is a case-by-case basis because you have to know whether or not there's a gas station or a Wawa or a housing complex. Or
is the eastern driveway in there, or is that further down?
The eastern is between those two.
It's between those two.
Yeah.
So that would be some of it.
Right. Okay. I think might be a park driveway as well on the corner of Paul. I can't really remember exactly. Okay. But you know, it's a relatively significant distance, and the figures are misleading because it makes it look like they're close, but they really aren't.
Then the only one other question I had specific to that was if I read your, and it was a later slide, you have traffic of over 250 cars coming in and out of Cabrini at 10 o'clock at night, if I saw the bar graph chart. Correct. Is that? Yes, this one. Did I read that correctly, that as late as 10 o'clock at night you have 250 cars? And from the...
That's the hour ending at 10 o'clock. So some of that could be front-loaded closer to the 9 o'clock hour. It could be a lot of people leaving from 9 to 9:30, for example.
But when I looked at...
And this is total in and out over three driveways.
This gets to my second part of the question.
Yep.
When I looked at the Delaware Valley chart, which might be the next page...
It is.
That would suggest, by adding 168 on... scoot up a little bit so I can see the name of the street. King of Prussia, I believe this.
This is King of Prussia, yes.
Right. And Eagle had 82 in the same chart, which is, you know, about...
Well, again, that's our beginning, so that's 10 to 11. You would look at the one that says 9, so it's 122 for Eagle. and it's 284 for King of Prussia.
Okay, then that's closer to the 300. Thank you. I was trying to get a sense of how much of this traffic was actually using that Upper Gulf Road.
That's 400 vehicles, and that's only two of roadways. If we went to Upper Gulf and added that in, that might be another 150.
That explains the difference. So. Thank you.
Yep.
I do have one quick question. The gentleman who had the map in your hand, does any of that show elevation, or is that just a plan view?
The plans we submitted actually all show elevations.
Does that show an elevation? Does what you have in your hand?
Yes, and it's the same plan that we submitted to you.
Can you put it down on the table so people can see it?
Yep, I actually might have a copy of it right here if you'd like.
That's even better.
Which are they down the bottom?
No. When you're saying elevations, you mean grade elevations or like building?
Picture of what the building looks like.
Oh, no, these are grade elevations. I thought you were talking topography. I'm a civil engineer. When you say elevations, I think grades.
I'm sorry. I was thinking architecture.
Yeah, the elevation that we have presented to you was that one.
That's what it's going to look like? Or theoretically so?
This was more a massing diagram to show what that massing. This is from Eagle Road looking up to where the entrance is.
Okay, now what's the pathway that you see in between that?
Right here?
Yes.
That's the entrance driveway.
Okay, and is that between the buildings? Or is that just the one end of?
No, that would be the main entrance driveway from Eagle, correct.
And that's in replace of the one that is coming off of Paul Road?
Correct. And Paul Road, we're closing down Paul Road, and it's just remaining
I understand. But that's the closest we're going to get to a picture of this thing tonight.
Yes.
All right.
Maybe.
What is the length of that little driveway that you showed there from Eagle Road to where it runs into a gate?
We don't have the gate placed yet. From the loop road, it's about 80 feet. From Eagle Road to the kind of the intersection area there. Mm-hmm. We've contemplated actually almost like when you go into some sites where they have a 4 points intersection like that, is that the incoming movement will be free flowing and then have three stop signs for the other three movements. And so when you come in, you can actually pull right all the way into to where the structure is.
So how is it a gated structure then? Or a gated?
Right, only at
property.
Night. Only at night will be gated. Okay. So from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m., this entrance will be closed.
And how will you get through the gate? Will there be a person there, or do you use an access card?
No, you have to use the upper Gulf Road entrance.
So once the gate is down, which would be about what time?
10 o'clock.
They'd have to come through Upper Gulf.
Correct.
Or how about through the front part off of King of Prussia Road?
That
can't get through there either?
That closes currently.
Okay.
At the last meeting, we talked about the PennDOT letter, and you said you had a PennDOT letter, and we've never seen the PennDOT letter.
I forwarded Sue Jones today. It was an email that we received from Fran Haney at PennDOT. We had a meeting with them. We followed up the meeting with a plan. Fran, you know, had a very short email back, which I provided. That said that this will be acceptable.
And not to pick on you personally or this application, but it is frustrating to us on the board to request something at a meeting and then it's available the day of the next meeting as opposed to sooner.
It was submitted to your township engineer. Your township engineer had a copy of it prior to the last meeting.
Okay, well, no one gave it to us. Whether it's our engineer or your firm, no one provided it to us.
I'm not sure how that distribution works.
And then we also talked about, and I appreciate that the Gilmore letter is very recent about traffic, but when could we anticipate in advance of another meeting seeing the Upper Gulf Road data plugged into this traffic study, which I think Frank was talking about?
When would you like it?
Tomorrow.
Well,
actually, we would have liked it before the meeting so we could have looked at it.
No, I think it will probably be within the next week, and I'll be happy to circulate it to all the Planning Commission members if that's the request. We really did receive it Wednesday, and last week went by very quickly, but it's my priority now. Thank you.
Any other board questions?
Yeah, I have a question about the parking. You stated that there's an additional 71 parking spaces after all this is done. I'm not getting those numbers. Can you just...
And actually, last month they said...
I'm going to correct Frank's numbers.
Yeah, thank you, because last month you said you had a goal of 1,050, not 1,023.
It's 1,066, I believe. Okay. Yes, 1,066. 952 currently, 1,066 proposed. Yeah, 114.
Those numbers that are listed, removed and added, are some missing there?
No. You're referring to sheet 3 of 10? Okay. That one was the out of date. The actual application on the big folded plans that you have, it's sheet 3 of 10 has the parking summary. And it goes through, and we've contemplated, as we talked about last time, the long-range plan and the implications of the long-range plan on parking. Subsequent to the last meeting, per your request, I met with the township zoning officer to go over the same parking analysis that we submitted back in, I want to say it was June or July, to the previous zoning officer. Went over that. The previous zoning officer accepted the our analysis. And also, Kevin, your current zoning officer, accepted the analysis.
You know,
can I just, I need some clarification here, because we're mixing things up, and I find it confusing. I'm sure the Planning Commission is going to find it confusing, and I'm sure the residents are going to find it very confusing. I think we need to focus on what is being proposed on this application, not what's being proposed in the future in conjunction with any other application. So if you could please clarify to me, how many parking spaces are you adding with the garage, and how many are being removed in this application, and where are they being removed?
As part of this application, there will be 116 parking spaces removed, and that's generally in the location of where the proposed structure is going to be built. There's a lot of parking down in that area.
Mm-hmm.
We are proposing these 711 parking spaces. We do not intend to reduce our existing nonconformity of parking. If we're required to, we will decommission other parking spaces on campus, and whether that's just, you know, fencing them off so nobody can use them, you know, we can go that route. What we've tried to do is use the township requirement of the long-range plan, contemplate the future projects that are listed in that long-range plan, and make sure that we're building, you know, our infrastructure, our parking, to accommodate that long-range plan and those requirements.
Thank you.
Peter, I have a question about the whole issue of nonconformity with regard to this plan, and as I look at page 3. And don't feel compelled to answer me tonight if you want to reflect on this question. When they start ripping up parking, aren't they basically giving up their nonconformity? Their pre-existing nonconformity. If I have an existing nonconformity in my front yard, and Kevin and I have spoken about this, maybe Kevin needs to weigh in on this one as well, and I remove my pre-existing nonconformity, I don't get it back at some later point, and I don't get to move it to the side of my house if I have a pre-existing nonconformity. So I'm wondering how this whole project long range, when they have an existing nonconformity of 910 parking spaces, when they start ripping up parking lots, if they're giving up their right to their pre-existing nonconformity, and at some point, maybe not with this project, but I just want to put this out there as they're in their planning, at some point they're going to have to conform and have 1,976 spaces, not 1,066.
Yeah. The nonconformity, as far as this project is concerned and this application, I believe they are improving the nonconforming status because they're adding additional parking overall by building this garage. And what they're removing is, I think, needs to be removed in order to add the garage. There's nothing, and I might be wrong, I don't really see most of the plans. Every once in a while I might see them for an hour, or even less than that. But my general, you know, sense on this plan is, one, they're adding parking, so they're coming out with more parking at the end of this than they have at the beginning. The parking that they are removing is necessary in order to build these garages, so that the if that is the case, if that's what's happening here, I don't think it really affects the non. It's okay because they're lessening the nonconformity; they're increasing the number of spots. That being said, in the future, when they come back and apply to construct any of the three buildings that they've proposed on their long-range plan, and in conjunction with the construction of those buildings, they are eliminating parking. That is an entirely different question. And I do believe early on in this project, I raised that concern with them that they may be setting themselves up to a situation where they can't rip out those lots because it's going to increase their nonconformity. But until I see that future plan and what's being proposed, I can't make a final opinion on that.
Kevin, maybe I guess my question needs to be directed to you then. Because I understood everything that Peter said, and I think everyone on the board understands that question. My question is kind of bigger picture. By removing 116 spaces as part of this project, aren't they basically giving up their right to the existing nonconformity of 910 spots?
I don't think
they're decreasing it by 116 spots. They're somehow.
Well, I think they're looking at the overall big picture and the future build out, and what they're saying is that any future additions, Bob, correct me if I'm wrong, they are providing parking per code. But as a result of, I guess, budgetary constraints and phasing of the project, they're going to start with this project and then progress down the line. They can't do everything all at once. They could come in, if they could do everything all at once, they would basically maintain that non-conforming status, but then provide the parking for any new building additions in accordance with the current code.
That's my concern, is that in the order in which they're doing this, they are holding on to an existing nonconformity that they might not otherwise be entitled to, and I'm still not sure that they are entitled to it by ripping up the 116 spots in their front to put it even in this garage.
Susan, the nonconformity is the number of spaces. It's not a nonconformity as to where the spaces are being provided. So what they're grandfathered in is there's a number of spaces that are necessary under the zoning ordinance to be provided in conjunction with this college use somewhere on the campus. So if they undertake some development that eliminates some spaces but then creates additional spaces elsewhere and that actually increases the number of spaces on the property, that's in compliance. They're still grandfathered. They're still right now, you know, basically the way you look at the grandfathering is at the time they became nonconforming as to the number of spaces they had at that time, that's what they're grandfathered to. And if they then over time increase the number of spaces on the property but yet don't reach what is required under the zoning code, that's still allowed, because they're actually lessening the nonconformity. They're lessening the difference between what they're obligated to provide and what they are legally required to provide because they're grandfathered in.
Yeah, but you know what I think?
This is like a general conversation about how this procedure works, and I think we can hold off on this a little bit and talk about it some more because it is very complicated. I'd like to move to the public input portion before it gets too late in the evening and make sure that everyone gets a chance to be heard. And then there'll be more time for more board comment following. Is that all right?
I was just going to ask a question. How far is that parking garage from the cartway of Eagle Road? Looking at the plans here, you know, I see a bunch of trees and so forth, but, you know, plans are deceiving.
I believe it's 120 feet.
It is.
From the right-of-way line, not the cartway. The cartway is probably another 10 feet or something like that.
Okay, 100 feet, 30 yards. And there are a bunch of trees and stuff we're planted now. Is there a roadway in between? Is that what I see?
Yeah. Yes, there is a driveway in between the structure and the...
Well, Doug, we're going to ask for elevations anyway, so we're going to find out all the details. Okay, can we have, thank you. We'd like to open it up to public comment. Please state your name and your address when you begin to speak. Hi.
Good evening. Matthew Marshall, 228 Walnut Avenue. I'm a former planning commission member and a resident, and I'm becoming a more concerned citizen over the planned institutional zoning and development in the township. And I'll try to keep this as brief as possible. I see this development as the most aggressively intrusive project since Villanova's planned health clinic at the corner of Aldwin Lane and North Ivan Avenue, and that was dating back about 5 or 6 years ago. I think what this illustrates, like that application, is that there's a complete insensitivity by the applicant to what is going on in the surrounding neighborhood. Why would you develop open space when you can easily pull this parking structure back to the interior of the campus and create much less burden on the neighbors? That's question number one. The traffic ingress and egress, it's not logical. Why would you take three existing means of ingress and egress and reduce that to one in an area that already has traffic problems? The Eagle Road corridor is the last of our open space in the northern part of the township. It's home to old growth trees and habitat for birds and other animals. Essentially what this plan is just an extension of what Eastern University did 5 or 6 years ago when they took 8 or 10 acres of open space along King of Prussia Road. They basically took 400 trees down and they encroached further into the neighborhood. They've lessened the buffers and they increased the stormwater problem, which is already significantly worsened by more development in the PI zoning. Number five, the steep slopes here, whether they're natural or man-made, I want hopefully the board to pay attention to that discrepancy, because I'm not sure there's an absolute ruling when it comes to steep slope, whether it's favored in one case or the other, and that has to be reviewed in the ordinance. Traffic. The traffic here is not going to be lessened. If you think about the corridor, cars leaving the campus are most likely going to 476 via Route 30. If cars leaving the parking structure, if they're going to Eagle Road and they're looking, in this case, to their left, heading towards King of Prussia, if they see taillights and parked cars, of course they're going to take a right turn, and the egress will become Paul Road or Radnor Street Road, which will eventually get to Walnut Avenue, Poplar Avenue, and eventually North Wayne, which will just increase traffic going to the west. And if they head up Paul Road to Chamonix, that will continue traffic going towards Lancaster Avenue. You know, where do you start with a parking structure on Eagle Road where you have deck parking that will ultimately detract from the open space, but also the view shed, and then what happens to the lights of the parked cars at night when they're shining into the residents' homes on Fairview and Chamonix? Basically, what this plan offers us is more cars, more parking, and more services to a township that's already stressed. My solution would be one of two. We've tried to change the PI zoning ordinance to eliminate these types of developments unsuccessfully, although we did try. I did personally. I guess my second solution would be let's consider a traffic impact fee for these types of developments, whether it be Eastern, Cabrini, or Villanova. Why not establish a number? It could be $1,000, it could be $5,000, it could be $10,000 per parking spot. And that could help reduce the burden to Radnor Township, which is already struggling with really more density and more traffic than it can bear. Thank you.
Thank you. Come on up.
Jim Rogers, 8 Paul Road. I've had the privilege of speaking to you before, and thank you for the privilege again. Each and every one of you individually and all of you collectively are the guardians of our neighborhood. What Mr. Marshall has just said is echoed by not only me, but by a number of other residents who are here that have similar concerns that you have all agonized over day by day and week by week since the applicant came forward. Maybe I could have a show of hands for the people that are here that are in opposition to this program in one shape or another. And thank you for the opportunity to address it, and please continue to be the guardians of the investments that each of us has personally, financially, and communally here in Radnor Township. Thank you.
Thank you.
Tom Rogers, I spoke at the last meeting. I live at 712 Woodcrest Circle. We submitted a petition earlier, 40 residents that signed it, who are extremely concerned about the location of this garage on Eagle Road and the amount of traffic that will be put on Eagle Road. It's a total of 750 parking spaces, if give or take, 500 of which are going to be commuters. And we've already seen from their various slides, there's going to be a lot of traffic put on there. And the problem is, if you're going west on Eagle Road, you go down the turn and up around the corner, it's a blind turn. I've almost hit several people walking on the inside of that turn. And when you go around that turn, I think it's about maybe 200 or 300 feet before the entrance. Our opinion is that it's going to create a tremendous amount of traffic, potential accidents, and could be some hazards. Plus the fact there have been several meetings by the college with the residents, and at the last meeting they stated that the residents were in agreement with this plan. Well, at those meetings we voiced difference of opinion, so we are not in agreement with those plans. Plus the fact the structure itself, even though it sits 120 feet back from the center of the road, you still have an access road in front of that, and you minimize the number of trees. They claim that they're going to be planting trees. Well, several years ago they planted trees along our property, which borders on Woodcrest Road and Woodcrest Circle, and they do not have the, I guess, time to water those trees, so we had to pull them all out. Our opinion is that we just feel as though they haven't really taken the consideration of the residents and how this plan will impact them. They also stated that eventually they will take out, I think, 698 parking spaces. So where is that traffic going to go? It's not coming in from Upper Gulf. It's not coming in from King of Prussia. It's going to be coming in from Eagle Road. So therefore, in that petition that we all signed, we're asking the board to take this into consideration and have the college go back and put that garage some other place other than Eagle Road. Thank you very much for listening, and we appreciate your concern.
Mr. Rogers, I have a question for you, if I could.
Go ahead.
You and your neighborhood group, are you primarily against the entire project, or are you against the road exiting onto Eagle Road?
Well, here's an example. They took over a piece of property, and I'm not too sure of the address, but it's on Berwyn Circle. The property was supposed to, it's adjacent to the college. The property was bought to be a home for the president. She's never lived there. And so far, they're accessing that with some of their vehicles, but there was a pool that was on that property and filled it in. And then the resident that lives next to him, lives next to that property, since they filled that pool, he has a drainage problem, because what's happened is he had to put a French drain in because the water coming down comes into his property. And also, since there's a lot of trees in his property as well as on Cabrini, several of those trees have fallen because of the excess of water that's come down. Our opinion is that they haven't really taken into consideration the impact on the community of what they're attempting to do. even though they claim this garage is going to allow more traffic, as you can see from the studies, 500 cars coming and going twice a day on a road that's already crowded in the morning as well as in the evening is going to create tremendous impact. I probably haven't answered your question.
No, you haven't. My question is, could you live with the parking garage being there if it was not accessed from Eagle Road?
No, because the parking garage itself is going to be a concrete block. It's not going to be, if I understand it correctly, to be in this community, you have to have a certain amount of shrubbery and trees or whatever around this community. This is a free space. There's a lot of trees, a lot of plantings, and it makes the community a nice place to live. Putting up a concrete block structure 120 feet off the highway is not attractive.
Well, I think the illustration they showed us was just for massing. That wasn't an architectural rendering of it.
I know.
Is that what you were going from?
I'm familiar with that.
Right. Have you seen an architectural rendering?
No, I have not. I haven't seen anything, but I am familiar with what the structure is going to look like if you take a parking space. If you take a garage 4 stories high and so long as they have indicated on the plan, it's going to be a concrete block no matter how you look at it. So I haven't seen the drawing, so I really can't look at it.
Okay, my question was, are you against the structure or just the road access? It sounds like you're
against
both.
We're against the structure and the road access,
okay.
Period.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm John Steele from 215 Walnut Avenue. Going to your question, against both the access by Eagle Road because of the additional traffic that it will cause, the congestion, diverting it off of Eagle, Upper Gulf, all the things that you've already heard, and I'm against the structure at that location. And again, that comes down to the distance, the fact that even with the buffer, it'll still be very visible, and we're still basically in a residential area in the township. I'm not going to repeat everything that everybody else said, but there was one thing as they're kind of going through the traffic diagrams. Obviously, you guys had the opportunity to see them at least a few hours before. You know, I was looking at them, you know, first thing, hand right here. There was one thing that I didn't.
That's not true. We haven't seen them.
Okay. Well, I knew you didn't have much lead time on there. I knew for me, I was like taking notes looking at it on the screen there. But the one thing that I noticed that maybe if you take a look at the diagrams there is when they were presenting the change or a potential change in traffic flow in Eagle Road, what I noticed was, I think it was the evening at King of Prussia Road and Eagle Road, it had gone from an F in the northbound to a worse F in the northbound, and Eagle Road eastbound had gone to, I think, a B or a C to an F. You know, so it's indicated directly in the diagrams there. It's going to say, yeah, things are definitely going to be worse in there at what's already a reasonably busy intersection. So. I think those were the key points that I had. I guess what one last question would be, and I think I know the answer, and I'm not asking it to you, but it's more rhetorical, is if I look at it from Cabrini's perspective, you know, they have, for example, on the northern side of the campus, what appears to be their largest parking lot, since they're going to basically be giving back parking spaces and then building a parking garage, that would then augment it by 100 spaces or so, why wouldn't they use that location on campus so it would not cause any change in traffic flow and wouldn't cause the changes from the visual aesthetics of the neighborhood? Thank you.
Thank
question,
you.
I'm over here on your left.
Yeah. Looking for the north.
That's all right. If all that traffic we're talking about putting out on Eagle Road went out to King of Prussia Road, would that bother you?
From a traffic standpoint, I mean, personally, it wouldn't affect me. I don't think it would have as much effect on a neighborhood, you know, if all the traffic went to King of Prussia Road. I still think it would make more sense for it to be just split between King of Prussia and Upper Gulf, because I'm sure that, you know, from a traffic study standpoint, and obviously don't know what the numbers are, that's still going to cause problems at that one intersection that's problematic today. But if the question is, do I care about the location of the garage? You know, that was kind of what I was saying right at the beginning is, you know, I care about the aesthetics, 120 feet back from the center line road with an access road in between, which obviously you're not going to have roads upon. I think it's going to affect the aesthetics there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi,
I'm Mary Sotheby. I live at 704 Woodcrest Circle. I actually hadn't planned on saying anything tonight, but I just wanted to make a comment. I find that we're spending a lot of time talking about this when there's a lot of patched together information. And I'd like to request that the original traffic study is more clear. I understand there was something done at Eastern, and then I think we added to it. And the comment was that the peak traffic time is between 8 and 9. And then in the evening, the comment was, well, it was the hour leading up to it. And I'll just go back to, if we're looking at the peak traffic time being between 8 and 9, I can share with you that the high school begins, I believe, at 7:30. I don't have a high schooler yet. But the middle school starts at 8. Most private schools start at 8:10. Radnor Elementary has all of their orchestra and band beginning at 7:45. Just in our area, the private school for the pickup for our neighborhood for private kids for the township bus is 6:55. There's another bus at, and that bus goes down Eagle and Paul Road at 7:05. And this will all come together in just a moment. On Radnor, there's a connector bus for children that go to all the private schools in the area as part of TE at 7:20. The Radnor Middle School bus comes through our neighborhood at 7:30. The Radnor Elementary activities I mentioned are at 7:45. And all this also is with all of these parents driving through the area. One thing, because I use this roadway often, and certainly I'm not an engineer, but I can just tell you, I cannot imagine left-hand turning. If you drive down Eagle and you're pointed towards King of Prussia, what we're not taking into account is currently there's no one turning left into a parking lot with holding everything up. Right now, Radnor has some bus schedules that are over an hour for children because of budgetary constraints. And I think that this would be a tremendous taxation for the bus system with the backups on Radnor Road, on Upper Gulf Road, on King of Prussia Road, on Eagle Road, through Chaminoy, and all those. I don't understand how you make all that work with all those parents and all those schools. So with all due respect, perhaps I wasn't listening closely enough, but I found this hard to follow. And I'm really struck by the number of times that you have said we don't have that information. And I, just as a resident, I'd really like to plead with you that you don't go forward until we're able to see the same things that we're required to give to the township as residents if we would like to improve our property, which is we do have to provide elevations and such. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Diane Klassen. I live at 707 Woodcrest Circle. My question really is to someone at Cabrini College. I'd like to know when the students left for Christmas break, December of 2011.
December 15th.
Okay, December 15th. And if I understand your description.
Please address all your comments directly to the board, not to the applicant.
So if I understood his study that was of Eagle Road primarily, it was done December 20th. Is that correct?
That's not what we were told. We were told it was done during school hours and not during any vacations.
Okay, so December.
That needs to be confirmed. We'll have to confirm it, but that's what we were told. I specifically asked that question. I was told it was done during school hours.
During school hours?
Yes.
Not during...
not during break, not
December.
During Christmas break, no.
Okay.
It was done in the spring, and it was done in November.
Okay.
It was done in April and November, the 2 months given to us by the traffic engineer.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Colleen Price, and I live at 352 Chimoni Road. To answer your question, I'm against the structure being built at all on that location on a forested area, which is truly the only area that we have left in North Wayne. Matt Marshall is completely correct about, really, go look at that land. That's all we've got left. And what they're going to put up here is going to wipe out that forested area. I tried to look to see how many parking garages do we have in Radnor Township, and I came up with about three. So this is a big development, something we normally don't handle. And I found that Bryn Mawr Hospital built a parking garage for about 700 cars. It's a six-story structure, three or below grade. So just take a look at how big Bryn Mawr Hospital's parking garage is. Double that. Take that all through that forested area, and that's what you're going to get. And I don't think it's going to look as nice as what Bryn Mawr Hospital did. They put some brick on it. This may look like a bunker. It's going to be hideous and across that entire expanse. And what's really happening here, they're saying they're going to end up with about 1,000 parking spaces, 711 on Eagle. They're moving their entrance to Eagle Road, same as what Eastern College is doing. So people are going to come and see the main entrance as Eagle Road. They're going to get off King of Prussia Road. I mean, I live there. I avoid King of Prussia Road like the plague. I never go on that road. And they're going to do the same thing. They're all going to be coming down Eagle, and they're going to learn all the shortcuts coming down Chamonix and Paul Road and up Walnut, and it's just going to devastate our neighborhood. And I did have a question about this whole nonconformity. I don't want to get into this whole issue, but when they came in with this application, I was told they were 920 cars short under our current zoning. I also was told if they build any kind of structure, they have to come into conformity with our code. So if they're adding 711 spaces, they should still be short 200 spaces. So I don't know how they're going to pass that muster. I know you're talking about not impacting the nonconformity and actually improving it by adding spaces, but you're still short 200 spaces. And they are building a structure, so I think it does make a difference. And if there's anything in that structure, like a storage room, I mean, according to the prior zoning officer, we had talked about Valley Forge Military Academy. They weren't conforming as to parking. He said, there's nothing I can do. The day they build a hut out there, if it's a 5x5 hut, they have built a structure, they're going to come into conformance on the parking. There's got to be some sort of storage closet facility for the gatehouse, something like that, that would be deemed a some sort of structure that I think that would require them to come into conformance with parking. I'm back on the whole slope issue. There's no way that's a man-made slope. Just walk that whole topography. The whole area is on a slope, from Valley Forge all the way down. I don't care if they tamped it down after one little section after they built the house. That is a natural slope. Just look at the general topography. I don't know about the peak hours. I mean, I think they run classes at 4:30 and again at 6, and I think their peak hours a little off because they really shouldn't be looking as much at 5, 6, maybe 4:30, 4:15 to 6, 6:15. And then I was wondering if you could go back. There was a page where you put up, I guess, how many, I don't know what page that was. I think it was like page 7, how many vehicles come out of all three entrances. And I'm roughly looking at all the peaks, and a lot of them are going over 300, and they probably had 15 across the board. Do we have 3,000 cars at Cabrini alone a day? I think that's what that study shows. That's huge. And to take it and switch that whole entrance to Eagle Road, and really what's going to happen is Chamonix Road is going to be the main entrance, because no one's going to drive down King of Prussia if you can come right up Chamonix and Paul and make a right and get in there. That's how I would go. I don't know if you could look at that page again, but I think it's at least, it came out to rough count, about 3,000 cars a day generated by Cabrini alone. And the last thing was about the gates. I mean, I think that's an uncalculated delay that has to go into assessing how fast the traffic will move on Eagle Road. The gate that's on Upper Gulf has got to be, I don't know, 200 feet off, 300 feet off Upper Gulf Road. This is going to be a much shorter distance. And Upper Gulf, according to them, gets about 200 cars a day. We're getting 771 on our side coming down Eagle Road with a shorter gap between coming off of Eagle Road and getting to that gate. I think you're going to have a huge backup on Eagle Road. And I know Eagle Road is supposedly a state road. It's pretty much a little quiet country road, and it's really, really narrow. It's not meant to be used as King of Prussia, like that type of a state road. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Frank Brown. I live at 726 Woodcrest Road. We have felt that Cabrini has been a wonderful neighbor for us for 40-some years, and we have embraced their other expansion plans over the years, even though it negatively impacted us with more lights and more traffic and more noise. But we think this development is going just too far. The environmental impact, I think, is very severe. earlier someone alluded to the fact that trees were planted and not watered and they died. We had some of those on the Cabrini property back of ours, and we saw that firsthand it happened. The greening of the campus is a wonderful thing to say, and I know the kids are going to love it. But it would appear to me, from what I've heard, the greening is going to be up toward Upper Gulf Road, where they're taking away the parking lots and this kind of thing, and it'll be nice pedestrian traffic for the kids. They'll enjoy it because it's going to be green. They won't have the traffic. And they've said that they want to get the traffic out of there, make it pedestrian friendly. But I think in the other end of the campus, where the garage is proposed and back of Woodcrest, this is where it's going the other way. The greening is fine up by Upper Gulf, but the negative impact is going to be down at the other end, where they're taking down the trees, taking the woods away, the shrubs away. I think that is going to be a very disappointing thing for the community and certainly for the neighbors. I thank you.
Thank you. Any additional public comment? Thank you. What I'd like to do now is to basically take the temperature of the board without getting into a big discussion. If we can try to resist, I'd like to know kind of where people stand, what they'd like to see. Why don't we just start at one end, if you don't mind, Kathy?
Last month, we asked for traffic studies. I asked to have them in advance so that we could look at them. Flashing by 14 confusing traffic studies with numbers that fly all over the place with arrows going in different directions, we can't evaluate it. Plus, we don't know if the current stuff is tied in with it, if it was just working on Eastern's numbers. So from my standpoint, I still think we don't have the information to make a decision on this. And I think I said early on that I did not like the location of it. And I think, and we've questioned that, and I understand that you're a good neighbor and all that stuff. I think building a parking structure where your gymnasium is on that large parking lot there makes much more sense to do it. It's closer to your buildings. Kids are basically lazy, so they don't want to travel that far in walking and everything. But I think the impact on Eagle Road is going to be extremely difficult. So I'm not ready to make a final decision tonight on this, because whatever the decision is, even though it's preliminary, it's something that we're going to have to live with going forward.
Okay, Skip.
I'm going to come back to comments I've made in prior meetings. I still do not understand why there aren't two garages at a minimum. I could see that might actually make sense because you have buildings at one end of the campus and buildings at another end. I do have a concern about all that traffic somehow entering onto Eagle Road. It's the narrowest of the three roads. I have a concern that Susan mentioned about the nonconformity. There's a moment in time in 2012 or 2013 when you'll have 1,547 parking spaces, and then suddenly you're going to end up at 1,066. I think you may not be able to go back to 1,066, and maybe now is the time to take that into consideration. Did I miss the appearance of the garage? I don't know if it's open and closed. I don't know if it's temperature controlled. I have a feeling it's just shelves stacked, and you can see the cars from the street. Am I correct in that?
We don't have that information yet.
Okay. Well, for a variety of reasons, we don't have that information yet, and I am not in favor of this plan the way it is with the information I have.
Echo a bunch of those comments. Personally, I think the garage is, I get the neighbor's concern. I guess several fronts. Number one, traffic. It's still not clear to me how much traffic is on Eagle Road, Gulf, and King of Prussia Road. From my standpoint, if the traffic could be simplified, if you could tell us what's on Eagle Road now, what's on the three roads now, and post-development, what's on the three roads. So how much is, you know, where the traffic's getting shifted and what's going in and out now? Just one number, you know, on Eagle Road, you know, with all the different directions. But I think everybody knows where the concern, where the bottlenecks are. So let's, if you could just simplify things and let us know, you know, how many cars are coming on Eagle Road that are bunching up at King of Prussia Road. That's where the bottleneck is. That's where everybody's concerned, if I'm hearing things correctly. So if that, and you could let us know, you know, how much, why is the, you know, are you, how much is coming in off of Upper Gulf Road, and are you, you know, are you going to put it all on Eagle Road, or are you just planning for all of Eagle Road to be conservative, or how much do you anticipate really coming on Eagle Road so we can really understand, you know, what is going on? I think everybody is scared to death because I think the information you provided is wholly inadequate. Personally, I don't have a problem with the garage where it is. I think it's actually a decent location. I think the fact that a half of it is underground is a benefit. I think if you put it up by the gymnasium, I think the people, you know, some of the other neighbors might have visibility, and if it's elevated, if it's a 2-3-story garage at that location. But not providing elevations and, you know, and your ability to screen it better, I think has hurt you and has brought out everybody's greatest fear. So that's what I'd like to see, because I don't know if I quite understand it either. And I'm not ready to do anything on it tonight either.
I could just interject something. I would like to see all the numbers. It's okay if you, on the
yeah,
parking,
I'd like, to, yeah.
I'd like to see the backup information. I can understand it if I have it before the meeting. I can't understand it if it's flashed up on a screen for 30 seconds. So if we can have that a few weeks, at least a week before the meeting next time, and then you can give a synopsis, but I want to see the raw numbers.
Can I make an addition to that? The synopsis I want to see, since they've already said they disagree with each other, is from our traffic engineer. I want the synopsis and the review of their plan analyzed by you and available to us in advance of the meeting, as it was today, but developed a little further if there's more data from Upper Gulf, for example, which we know is not in the numbers we saw tonight.
I'd like to say, first of all, that I'm all for parking garages. I think it's the way we should go in the future, and I think that Cabrini should have some. I think this building is completely in the wrong place. I think that the reason parking garages are good is because environmentally, they don't take up as much land. But when you lose that environmental benefit by building on a wooded, steep slope that is lovely, you've lost the high ground there with building a parking garage. The parking garage needs to be somewhere else on the property. I'm not going to propose where, because that's, you know, there are probably many options. The other thing to consider is that part of that parking garage can still be underground. It's not only on a steep hill where you can put it underground. You can put it, some of the stories underground elsewhere, so you don't have to picture a Bryn Mawr-type building. I actually feel better about the traffic situation since hearing from the traffic expert for Cabrini, as well as our staff traffic people. Especially with the consideration of the left turn lane into Eagle, I would feel more comfortable with that. However, to me, that's almost irrelevant because I feel so strongly that that building is in the wrong place. No matter where that building is, it's unusual for Radnor Township. We can't envision it like we can if you say we're putting in a Rite Aid or we're putting in a housing development. We can envision that. Even though this is the preliminary stage of the development, we need graphics. We need an elevation, we need pictures, we need to see how it relates to the land, we need to see what the surfaces are going to be, the materials, the texture. We need to be able to get an idea of the bulk of the building, because this is new for us. This is not something that we normally do. And I can't see moving forward without that information.
The good news about the fact that you don't have plans yet is that you have not invested a tremendous amount of money in engineering. So it is not too late to move this building. It's exactly as everybody has spoken here. To take what is virgin, beautiful, wooded land and desecrate it is just wrong. And there are lots of other options. And building on your large parking lot that is already impervious and putting some of it underground is the way to do that, in my opinion. The issue of the left-hand turn lane will already require you to move this building back because you don't have enough right-of-way. And the concern that Colleen Price brought up about, I mean, I'm struck by it looking at this plan, to see that there's several hundred feet where you can turn off of Upper Gulf Road before you hit that fence, that gate. To think that someone could pull into this parking lot, parking garage off of Eagle Road on a very short stretch of road and have to turn around or just, there's just not enough room there. It's not the right place. It's not the right place.
For me, it's fairly simple in that you're consolidating 70% of the parking in one location with direct access to Eagle Road. I understand as a methodology to the traffic study and the data points are great, but no information doesn't reflect the 70% consolidation at one location. And environmentally and everything else, all the other issues that everyone brought up, I think, are just pointing to what we've been saying all along is that this is in the wrong location. All of that input has never been investigated to see what an alternate location would look like. We've asked for several alternatives, none were ever provided. It just gives us a frustration level that you're not working with us on this project. So I think you get the picture.
I think even with the left turn lane, I can't get on board with this additional access off of Eagle Road, exactly for the reasons that were pointed out, that it's gonna increase the traffic through the neighborhoods. In looking at this, and you know, any additional parking that's provided may increase traffic to the campus, but by redirecting it to this location, you're going to change the traffic patterns throughout the township to the detriment of the residents, and I can't support that. Also, I don't feel like it's still incomplete, the traffic information, and I think we need to see more.
Last but not least, I certainly understand your objective of trying to take the center of the campus and make it almost like an oasis for the students. That's a logical and rational thing to do if it were my property, and I were trying to do that. It's a real customer focus, if you will. I hate to think of students as customers, but you know, that's really what they're trying to do. And so the intent is great, but this particular location, this particular style of garage, I think, is not what we really need for it. I'm really concerned about how close it is to the road and the fact that even with the most wonderful trees or bushes and so forth, you're still going to see this thing from the street. I would prefer to see it put somewhere else on the campus. I would also, the traffic coming off of it onto Eagle Road, I needn't say anymore. Okay, I would like to see it go into King of Prussia Road, which is a more heavily traveled road and one which is more likely to be able to bear the load. By building this, if we, you know, we keep some of the other parking garage or parking spaces in fourth floor, in effect, we're putting in place the ability to build new buildings down the road. And one thing that bothered me about the comment here was when you look at a new building that's built, we look at the parking just for that rather than the campus as a whole. That's part of the discussion that we need to have down the road. But I'm sorry, as much as I would like to be able to support you all, I can't support this as it currently stands. I do look forward to your coming back with something which is top notch. Thank you.
I have a question for the staff. Where are we on timing with this application? Do we need to vote? Do we need?
No, we believe we have an extension and through middle of April.
Okay. I have a question. Do we have comments yet from Delaware County Planning? And Amy, this is a quick question for you. And Mrs. Price got up and did those numbers. Is it accurate that over the course of the day there's 3,000 cars in and out with that bar graph?
That was the first time that I've seen that bar graph, so I wouldn't be able to give an opinion on that unless he wanted to put it back up and I mentally calculate. I don't know. It wouldn't surprise me that during the course of a day that you might have that kind of, that amount of traffic coming in and out of the site at the three accesses, but I can't say positively.
This is an aside. Peter, can you prepare a memo for us on this nonconformity issue?
Certainly.
Thank you. Any other comments from the board? Is there anything else we can share with you to give you the direction we'd like you to take?
I think you've been pretty explicit, and we'll be back taking into consideration the various comments we've heard. I do believe, however, that some of the comments are more appropriate for a final plan than for a preliminary plan, and we can adjust accordingly. I gather it's difficult for you to visualize what we've had, even though it's just a preliminary plan. And also, there are some other issues, I think, that while they've been stated, we haven't given an opportunity, and I don't want to take any more time to refute certain things, but it's clear from our engineers meeting with the zoning officer and with Matt Bauman that there is no dispute that these are man-made steep slopes, and that's a zoning issue. We have been operating in good faith as a result of that meeting, and things of that nature. We can go on, and I don't want to get into any more.
That's fine.
This evening, we've got enough of your flavor of what it is you would like changed, and we'll take that into consideration with what we can do and can't do. But I do believe that I think some of the topics discussed tonight shouldn't be taken as facts just because they were said. I think there were some misstatements.
We will look forward to more information coming our way.
All right. Thank you.
And also, just a reminder to you, but also to our staff and to ourselves, any reports, any letters that we're going to be going over in the meeting, we need to get in advance of the meeting. It makes it much easier for everyone to be on the same page.
And actually, in advance does not mean the afternoon of the meeting,
right,
but in advance, like a week before, so we can actually have time to read them and go over them.
And that's also to our staff. I know you send it to us as you get it, but we can't go over this type of stuff the afternoon of a meeting, you know, because the emails, I know we got a bunch of emails in the last couple of days, but we really need the information a week before the meeting, if it's anything that needs to be digested.
Okay, do we need to vote to table, or are we just, we're okay now?
I think in the past you've taken a vote to table, so.
Would anyone like to make
that.
A motion?
I'll make a motion, we table.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
I think the next, I've lost my agenda. Is there any old business?
There you go.
Any old business? Any new business?
Actually, it's sort of old and new.
Go ahead.
And the more
we don't have an old and new category.
Okay. So put it in both then. I think a year ago, maybe more, I brought up how bad our institutional zoning is. At that time, I spoke to the township manager, and I said the Delaware County Planning Commission does write ordinances. They could at least work on the institutional for us, and then if we hire somebody, which I understand we're in the midst of doing, that that could be changed then. But we need to get something in now. The institutions are going to be built up by the time we get that zoning. And I think the fact that Villanova is going to be coming in with a huge development, which we've seen through the newspapers and everything, because they're doing PR all over the place, that's going to make this look like chicken feed, not to, you know, denigrate Cabrini or anything. But
so how would you propose, though, that we move that ahead? Should we make
a recommendation?
I
think we need to put pressure on the commissioners,
yeah,
to move on this institutional before we get around to hiring somebody. Let's work with Delaware County Planning Commission. Let them put something together.
Okay.
Let's get that passed so that at least we have that to work with, because our hands are tied.
Okay.
So then,
the parking situation is really bad.
So if we ask the staff to prepare a memo from the Planning Commission to the Board of Commissioners stating what you just said,
right,
that'd be the first step.
And then I would push it.
Okay.
We have to do a little lobbying here.
I'd like to add something on the institutional zoning.
Go ahead.
The township did enter into an agreement with a consultant to start on that ordinance amendment. That consultant has started some of the background work. I'm expecting within the next week some of that draft preparation to go forward. We are currently working on identifying a study committee to work with the consultant. So that process has been started, and we are moving forward with that.
What's your best guesstimation on when we could have some zoning in place?
Without seeing what the consultant has already put together, I can't comment on that at this point.
What's the process for adopting that?
Well, it'll have to go through the normal process where the consultant will be doing all of the background information and preparing an amendment through a series of public information, public meetings, public input, preparing something. It will go to the commissioners. It will be in front of you, where then it will go back in front of the commissioners. The county will have an opportunity to provide comments. I'm sure you will see that before it's provided to you for comments. Ultimately, then it will get to the commissioners for their review and consideration.
So if a institution submits a plan, a preliminary plan, and before that zoning code is adopted, they're automatically grandfathered
under our present code.
Yeah. They're automatically in with the existing code the way it exists today.
Yeah.
So it's a race.
From what I've seen, it would probably, my guess is, and depending, are they going to do separate sections or are they going to do the whole works and pass the whole works?
From the institutional side?
From any side. How are they going to approach? Are they going to, what's their first project in there?
I believe they're just amending the institutional committee? Section of the zoning ordinance. We're not
that
doing
would be
a,
the first thing?
Correct. We're not doing an overhaul of the entire zoning ordinance
just
at this
institutional.
Point. Just the institutional.
Okay. I bet we're looking at a year. And, everybody's going to be in by that time. Yeah, so we're stuck with what we have.
Even here, so this project, for example, would be strictly related to the parking garage. The next project in for buildings would apply, assuming the new code's in place and has been adopted, would apply to that. If they want to build another building up on the where they're taking parking
that would
garage.
Be the new, whatever code was in place when they brought the application in.
Okay.
Which could, unfortunately, still be this one.
Yeah.
Can we take an approach where we limit some of these applications to certain?
No.
You can't. Once they apply, it's they can put the whole long range plan.
We
in
can't
right
hold
now.
People up because we can't get our act together.
No, submitting the long range plan isn't submitting a plan.
But I'm saying if they have a plan for their long range plan fleshed out, it's in.
An actual preliminary plan, then it's in. Yeah.
Okay.
I would like to make one comment here. One thing that I think we should try to do is see if we can get the Board of Commissioners to refine a parking structure or revise defining a parking structure as a building, because currently it's not a building. And it doesn't have to, all the things that apply to having a building approved don't apply to parking structures. That's why he said, if you put a little closet in there, which is not the parking, mm-hmm. then it's a building. Okay, but if just a parking structure, it doesn't apply. That would be quick and easy. Famous last words.
Do that.
Wave your magic wand.
Is there any additional public comment?
No public.
I move we adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Aye.
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 All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.